Good morning, everyone, and welcome to the second meeting of the Rural Affairs, Islands and Natural Environment Committee in 2023. I can remind members using electronic devices to switch them to silent. We have apologies from Jenny Minto today, and we welcome back Emma Harper, who is attending as a substitute, and Rachel Hamilton will be participating remotely. Our first item of business is to take items, to agree to take items 5 and 6 in private. Our members, do members agree? Thank you. Our second item of business is consideration of the Legislative Consent Memorandum for Shark Fins Bill. And I welcome Mary Gujan, the Cabinet Secretary for Rural Affairs and Islands, and her supporting officials, Alan Gibb from Marine Scotland and Emma Phillips from the Scottish Government's Legal Directorate, are joining us remotely. And if I could remind the officials remotely, if you wish to speak, if you could type R into the chat box. And could I invite the Cabinet Secretary to make an opening statement?
Thanks very much, and good morning to you, Convener, and the rest of the committee. And thank you for inviting me to speak about the Shark Fins Bill and the associated legislative consent motion. Shark finning is the practice of removing fins from a shark at sea and returning the finless body to the water. The Shark Fins Bill is intended to ban the import and export of shark fins obtained using this cruel practice. This is a private member's bill which has been introduced by Christina Rees MP, and it was introduced in June last year. It passed committee stage at the House of Commons on the 16th of November with broad cross-party support, and I understand that the bill has passed the third reading in the UK Parliament last week and is now due to be considered by the House of Lords. It's right that we maintain the ban on shark finning practices in Scottish waters and ban the import and export of detached shark fins or things containing them. I was pleased that we were able to secure an amendment that, to ensure that appeals against certain decisions of the Scottish ministers relating to exemption certificates and final penalty notices are to be made to the first tier tribunal for Scotland rather than the UK-wide first tier tribunal dealing with reserved matters. This amendment reflects that these matters fall within devolved competence. I understand that there has been constructive working between my officials and officials in the other fisheries administrations throughout this bill process, and that's ongoing, to ensure that there is that coordination on the implementation and ultimately the enforcement of the bill. I'm really pleased to recommend supporting this bill as it aligns with key Scottish Government priorities, including reversing biodiversity loss and enhancing marine environmental protection. And the bill also reaffirms Scotland's firm commitment to animal welfare and ensures that we speak with that greater credibility when we're advocating for shark conservation on the global stage. And that's why I've recommended this legislative consent motion on the bill. Thank you.
Thank you, Cabinet Secretary. It's one of these topics we see in the agenda and we think, how could it possibly apply to Scotland? But could you set out to what extent shark fin has previously been fished or traded in Scotland? And you also mentioned exemption certificates. Could you tell us exactly what that means and why, if I understand correctly, there should be some exemptions to allowing shark fin fishing?
Oh, absolutely. Well, that's the thing. The act of shark finning has been banned in the UK since 2003. And we have a fins naturally attached policy in relation to that. But what has still been permitted through that time is the personal imports of shark fins. So there's been a 20 kilogram allowance in relation to imports. So that's what this bill will be drawing an end to. Now, we don't think that there has been a tremendous amount of trade within that time. I think, as far as I'm aware, since 2017 across the UK, I'm not aware that there has been much movement within that time, but I think it's important that that loophole is closed, which is exactly what this bill is looking to do. In relation to the second point about the exemptions to that, there are some exemptions within this, and that is only in the case of if it's for the benefit of conservation of the species, if there was a need to import a product that, say, contains shark fins or a shark fin itself. But that's the only case in which that would be permitted to enter the country.
Thank you. Ariane Burgess.
Thank you. Cabinet Secretary, the bill amends retained EU law. If the retained EU law bill passes, it is assumed that this regulation would need to be retained before 2023 to ensure the bill can operate. What discussions has the Scottish Government had with the UK Government on this?
In relation to retained EU law, those discussions are ongoing with the UK government. So we had our meeting with the UK government and the other devolved administrations just at the start of this week, actually, because retained EU law is an ongoing process, but we are continuing to have those discussions to see what the impacts are going to be. In relation to this bill in particular, I haven't raised that specific point in relation to that, but like I say, it is an ongoing process.
When do you think you'll have the opportunity to raise that?
I am, again, these discussions are ongoing at the moment because we're still trying to look at that with the UK government in terms of retained EU laws to what's going to be preserved. I'm not able to give a definitive response to that right now, but of course we will be considering that.
Thank you.
Beatrice Wishart.
Thanks, Convener. The bill sets out some financial costs and states that there'll be ongoing operational costs, although it says that these would be difficult to quantify. So I wonder why they're difficult to quantify and to what extent that these costs will fall on the Scottish Government, Marine Scotland.
Yeah, the costs in relation to the bill, I think, mainly fall in relation to any the additional powers or what we would be asking of the First Tier Tribunal for Scotland. I mean, it's not possible for us to quantify that at the moment without knowing how many or potential cases might come forward. There's the additional training that would be needed in relation to that as well. So again, just as I was saying in a previous response, from 2017, as far as we're aware, there hasn't been this trade. But without knowing if there are how many cases could potentially come up, it's hard to put an exact figure on what that could be at the moment. I mean, I don't know if officials would have anything further to add in relation to that and in relation to the costs.
No. Not at the moment.
Thank you.
Any further questions? Mercedes.
Thank you. The Minister mentioned that it would prevent the import of shark fins, and I wondered if you have any further information about fins being used as part of other products, like, I don't know, ground up or incorporated into other products, and if there's been any research into the impact of the import ban on those products, like how widespread that is. I don't know if you have any information on how common shark fin importing.
And to be honest, that's been one of the interesting things about going through the process and looking at the discussions that have taken place on this bill. So in terms of some of the analysis that DEFRA had done, well, they estimated that the impact on business just more generally would be in the region of about £200,000. But I think that's one of the positive things about this piece of legislation as well, is that it's not just shark fins themselves. It also prohibits the import and of things containing shark fins. So that could be tinned shark fin soup as an example of that as well. So it is encompassing in that regard.
Thank you.
Thank you. Emma Harper.
Good morning, Cabinet Secretary. Just looking at the briefing papers, it says that the global trade in shark fins is estimated to be 16,000 to 17,000 tonnes per year, resulting in the deaths of 97 million sharks annually. That's huge. So I just wanted to make sure that that was pointed out. But obviously, you're saying that it's not a big issue for us in Scotland, for instance, but just wanted to make sure that that was something that we actually were quite vocal about.
Oh, you're absolutely right. And I think it's important because I think that was one of the things, again, that shocked me in looking at the information here. Because you're right, we haven't, it's been banned in the UK since 2003. That isn't a practice that generally takes place here. But I think there were some other figures that around, I think for the 1 to 2 million tons of shark fins traded, you need 73 million sharks to provide that. And it's a really cruel and horrendous practice. And I think that this bill is an important step forward in trying to put an end to that trade and encouraging that practice.
Mm-hmm. Jim Fairley.
Thanks, Convener. That was one of the points I wanted to actually get on record, was the sheer scale that has come to us in the briefing paper. 97 million sharks killed for 16,000 to 17,000 tonnes of fins. It's horrendous. But you just mentioned there about shark fin soup in tins. Do we import tins of shark fin soup that are already in the tins and where do they come from?
I mean, I would have to look into that in more detail. I mean, that's covered by the import ban at the moment. I couldn't give you an idea at the moment in relation to the scale of what that trade would be just now. Again, I don't know if officials would have any further information on the specifics of that question.
Yeah, the point that I'm making is we'll ban the import yes. of shark fins in the raw, as it were, for want of a better word. But we would still be encouraging that trade if we were allowing already processed shark fins to come into the country as a product to be consumed.
Yes, so that's why the import ban covers shark fins and things containing shark fins as well.
Thank you.
Grant, thank you very much. That concludes our evidence session. So thank you to the Cabinet Secretary and your officials for attending. The committee will now review the evidence we've heard and discuss a report in private, and now to spend the meeting, or we go into private and we'll return in public session at 10 o'clock.